his head.
Hey, what's going on? This is Qbear
and Tinderhoof from FluidDruid.net. We're bringing you the heroic Maloriak encounter from Blackwing Descent.
Basically, as you can see, I get my 5 combo point rip up, and then I'm going to start to pull energy.
Biggest difference you're going to see on this fight is there's an extra phase added, so you're going to start seeing it come up right here. This is a phase where he's going to start spawning a whole bunch of small little adds that leave black puddles in the ground.
That's correct. What happens is black phase will always be the first phase you see in every transition between green phase and the next phase, and then you'll start getting your RNG between red and blue phase. So what I do is I save my berserk for this phase, and then I'll pop that with the tiger spear to try to get maximum swipe damage on all these adds.
What you'll notice is a little debuff is popping up in the corner there. If you're standing in the black puddles, it's going to be doing a lot of damage. And just to illustrate the point, you'll see Q standing in as many puddles as he possibly can.
That's totally correct. But what happens is that I have such faith in my healers that I know if I simply purple bark skin, I'll actually be able to take the damage from the puddles and be able to get maximum DPS on this the oozes, which needs to happen for this black phase. Once all those are dead, you can feral charge back into Maloriak and start getting good single target rotation on him.
As soon as all the adds die, he'll transition to the next red or blue phase, and it looks like he's going to be blue phase this time.
That's correct. What happens next is completely RNG based on your raid group. So next will be blue phase. What happens here is you'll actually stack amongst all the melee, wait to see who gets the biting chill, and once biting chill goes out, you'll either stay in melee or run out depending on if you have or don't have the diva.
Something real good to think about is when the timer's getting close, refresh your rip and your rake if you can, because if you're forced to run out, at least they're not going to fall off.
Yeah, as you see, I do have to run out here as I get biting chill, as you can see against my player fan right there. Once the debuff hits about 1 second left, I'll start the feral charge in for that free ravage proc. Get good single target again since I wasted so much time not getting combo points, and do my best to make sure I can maintain the rips, the savage roar, and the rake on the target.
When you're starting to get to the end of this phase, you're only going to have about another 30 or 40 seconds in the red phase, so if you're going to be saving your Tiger's Fury and another Berserk for the green phase, you want to make sure you're not going to be blowing it here, so keep an eye on that.
One thing I do want to mention is you can see, as I did, basically when red phase starts, Scorching Breath will not start immediately. So what I want to do is I want to maximize my rip glyph, make sure I get all three extensions of the rip on the Maloriak target. And then once all three have been extended, then I'll move in front of the boss and start my mangle spam.
So while we're waiting for the green phase to kick off, we can talk about some of the virtues of the Tiger's Fury glyph or the Berserk glyph.
That's totally correct. Basically, in my experiments, trying to do Tiger's Fury on this fight is just going to be completely ridiculous. I'm a little intoxicated right now as we're making this video. So as you can see, once everything gets swiped down, I just do single target on set before I move back to the boss. Basically what happens is Tiger's Fury glyph, in my opinion, is only good on fights where you can maximize Tiger's Fury Ravage on top of each other, since the cooldowns will match up the same. Since this is a fight where I'm talking about 60% of your damage is going to come from swipe, definitely Berserk glyph will shine over Tiger's Fury in this fight.
I totally agree. For the most part, when you're going to be doing a whole bunch of your swipe spamming, if your expertise and hit cap, like both Q and I have been experimenting with, you're going to get a lot better chance of getting OOC procs, and if you get those off, you're going to get the best chance of being able to make use of all 20 seconds of that glyph, as opposed to just the normal 15 seconds.
And another great thing is Omen of Clarity OOC actually has a usual average proc chance of about 3 times per minute. However, when you're hitting so many targets at once, you're actually increasing that proc per minute of chance, or BPM that we usually call it. So when you're using Berserk Glyph, you're getting so much more attacks off than the normal, you know, Feral Kitty would usually be able to do. And since you're getting so many more attacks off, you're actually increasing your proc per minute chance of Omen of Clarity. So you can actually get more attacks off using the same amount of abilities just by switching Glyphs.
Yeah, one other thing to consider when you're gearing up for this fight is the Feral Druid favorite trinket, the Unheeded Warning. The proc for the weapon damage does not actually help swipe at all. So for a huge portion of the DPS on your fight here, you're not going to be making use of that. So if you have another trinket available, like Fluid Death, it would probably be best to swap that out for this fight.
That's another great thing to mention, because Fluid Death against the Unheated Warning will actually increase your ability to get more mastery, you know, out of your rips and your rakes, while Unheated Warning is only going to increase your Shred and Mangle damage, since the fact that the two trinkets differ so greatly. Basically what happens is, you know, Fluidruid is definitely going to win out against this fight, since you're going to get a higher mastery and easier to reach your caps as far as hidden expertise goes. You're going to be able to maximize your swipe damage, your bleed damage, and everything against just trying to maximize your Shred and Mangle damage, which basically you're not going to be casting that many throughout this entire fight.
Yeah, the only time you're going to be doing it is in between the phases and then the final, like, 25%. So definitely want to look at investing in that trinket if you don't already have it.
Yeah, especially so much, since Swipe is literally going to be making up over 60% of your damage for this fight.
So as the fight's starting to wind down to the final phase, you'll notice that they're starting to not do as much DPS on Maloriak, but they're switching to the adds early, where the melee just has to kind of sit and take it.
That's definitely a good point to bring up. What's going to happen is that 25% of this guy is going to push into phase 3. And so you really need to make sure that all the adds have spawned by this point and all of them are dead. The only way to make sure that they're all going to die is as soon as they hit green phase. As you see Maloriak hit right now, we basically kill all the adds once he hits his final green phase, and then we push the boss into phase 2, which will then go for the kill.
And just like the normal phase, frost orbs will be spawning along with the giant green acid explosion. And then the fire trails. So try to be keeping as close to him as possible without getting in danger of having frost orb blow up on you.
And this is why I love being part of a community such as FluidDruid, because as much as we are about maximizing DPS, all of us really, really need to know that maximizing your survivability is going to increase your DPS by such a huge threshold. You'll see those orbs spawn in melee and immediately pop, but you'll never see me get hit by one. It's basically saying that melee just need to pay bigger attention to what's going on around them. If you can maximize your survivability, I guarantee you'll start to out-DPS all your melee, as long as they're failing to such simple mechanics as frost orbs on fights like this.
Plus, it's a lot more funny to be able to make fun of them when they're laying dead on the ground and you're going, ha-ha!
Definitely, ha-ha is the way to go. But all in all, this is the heroic Maloriak encounter. I'm Qbear, and also with
Tinderhoof from FluidDruid.net. If you feel that you want a little bit better explanation of the abilities that this boss has to offer, I highly recommend you check out the videos at LearnToRaid.com.
And as far as maximizing Feral DPS, we'll definitely catch you on the next boss kill and take.